All right, we'd like to welcome everyone to Costa Rica Community Church. Happy Father's Day.
Good morning. We would like to welcome everyone to Costa Rica Community Church and happy Father's Day to all the fathers around us and on video. We welcome our video audience and would like to share a note that we had from Norm, who's our YouTube video specialist. And he wrote, "Our views and time watched is up quite a bit in the last few weeks, which tells me that a lot of our congregations treating Costa Rica Community Church as their home church and the videos as their weekly service, which is very encouraging." On behalf of that, I want to thank Robert for doing the message each Sunday. Geraldine, you had some announcements?
Wow, I've got to have this down there so you can hear me right. First off, I want you to know that Rod has been diagnosed with COVID, and he is home. That's why he hasn't been here for the last couple of weeks. And he is in need of some maybe food or some encouraging notes. So if that's something you are up to, we appreciate it. Also, I received two messages yesterday, one from Rose Bond and another one from Valerie, that a family in Villa Obregon, their house is burned, they lost everything, they need everything. These are a pair of friends or acquaintances of both of these ladies, and so I'd like to be able to reach out to them in some manner. We don't have clothing any longer here at the church, but we do have 100 new food bags, so maybe some food we can take over there, or at least go and see if there's something we can do, or maybe whatever any individual wants to do would be appreciated. Thanks. Don't forget potluck and session 2 of The Chosen at our house Tuesday night.
Thank you, Darlene. But let's just read a tribute to Father's Day since we're celebrating Father's Day. Today we honor the fathers in our lives. Before Batman ever made an appearance, many of us believed that our dads possessed superpowers. In the spirit of giving due honor, here is to the dads who are passionate about pursuing Jesus and have made him the priority in their lives. They embrace their position as a spiritual head of their home and earnestly seek the will of their Heavenly Father. Here's to the dad who realize that honoring their wives, second only to the Lord, is the best gift that they can give their children. They work diligently to provide for their families and intentionally create a safe space where their lives and children are liberated to become who God created them to be. Here's to the dads who are present and positive participants in their children's lives. They train their children to love and obey Jesus, to take them to church and to speak blessings into their future. They chase down fly balls, dress up for daddy-daughter dances, and tell all the corny jokes. Great dads can be found roughhousing in the backyard, cheering from the bleachers and tutoring at the kitchen table, helping a neighbor change a tire, holding his wife while she cries, raising his hand in worship, and a thousand other places. They may not be our last hero, but they were certainly our first. Here's to all the dads. Happy Father's Day. So we're starting with the first reading of Job, chapter 1, 13 to 22. One day when Job's sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house, a messenger came to Job and said, "The oxen were plowing and the donkeys were grazing nearby, and the Sabians attacked and made off with them. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one who escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, "The fire of God fell from the heavens and burned up the sheep and the servants, and I am the only one who has escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, "The Chaldeans formed 3 raiding parties and swept down on your camels and made off with them. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one who has escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, yet another messenger came and said, "Your sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house, when suddenly a mighty wind swept in from the desert and struck the four corners of the house. It collapsed on them, and they are dead. And I am the only one who escaped to tell you." At this, Job got up, tore his robe, and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship and said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." In all this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. Reading of God's word. Please join me standing to sing, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and that we may perfectly love you and perfectly magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me in singing, Great is thy faithfulness, on the help of our great thou art.
I'm going to be reading from Luke 13, 1 through 5. Now there were some present at the time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifice. Jesus answered, "Do you think these Galileans were worse sinners than all the Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will perish. Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish."
We received your offering at this time. May we stand and sing the doxology together.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Pray with me the prayer of the community, please. You may be seated and read the words that are printed in God's print, please. Almighty and ever-living God, who has taught us to offer prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people, we ask you mercifully to receive these our prayers. Inspire all church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and harmony. We pray you also to lead the nations of the world into the way of righteousness, and so guide and direct their leaders, that your people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Grant to the governments of Mexico, Canada, and the United States, and to all persons in authority, that they may truly and impartially administer justice, uphold integrity and truth, restrain evil, and maintain true religion and virtue. We pray for peace in the world. Make wars to cease, O Lord. Protect the innocent. Restrain all evil. To stir up nation against nation. Where nations are at strife within themselves, raise up leaders who know the way to unity. To the people of troubled and warring nations, inspire the world to pursue peace. Give grace, Heavenly Father, to all who proclaim the gospel. Help us to fulfill your great commission, making disciples of all nations and teaching them to obey all that you have commanded. And to all your people, give your heavenly grace, especially for us who worship here, that with reverent and immediate hearts, we may hear and receive your holy words, truly serving you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our life. And we ask you in your goodness, Lord, to comfort and relieve all who in this transitory life, sorrow, well, need, sickness, grief, or any other adversity, especially those for whom our prayers are desired. For the family whose house has burned. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. But above all, for your inestimable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace, and for the hope of glory. Give us that due sense of all your mercies, that our hearts may be truly thankful, and that we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom, with you in the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. And we turn once again to the Word of God, reading from Romans chapter 8, verses 8 and 25 and 28. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay, and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. We hope for what we already have. But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. The word of God.
Good morning. I moved house this week. Some of you have been through that recently, and you know the frustrations. But to make matters worse, in the course of moving, I lost my cell phone, complete with 150 contacts. And I thought, what did I do, Lord, to deserve this? That's the question that Job's friends wanted him to ask. Of course, the book of Job tells us that that's the wrong question. Anyway, I went to see Maria, the telephone lady, to buy a new phone, but Maria had the foresight to send me back home and told me to wait there while she called my number. 20 minutes later, I heard it ringing. It was out in the common area of our bungalows on a chair, concealed under my new dustbin. I baked her a pecan pie for a thank you. That brief panic brought back memories of other electronics disasters that did not end quite so well. Like the time when I backed a car up over my Army laptop that I'd left lying on a parking lot at Canadian Forces Base Gordon. Or the time when my Palm Pilot traveled safely on the roof. Remember Palm Pilots? Yeah. Traveled safely on the roof of my car until I merged onto Highway 401, and then out of the corner of my eye, I saw it take flight. Or the time when I was working with the church in Belize, and a man came to my door wanting some money so that he could go visit his mother in Dandriga. And being the new kid on the block, I gave him the money. And then he asked me, Padre, would you pray for me before I go? Well, of course. And then after he'd gone, I realized that while my eyes were closed, he had pocketed my cell phone from the kitchen table. Actually, it wasn't my cell phone. It was the bishop's cell phone, and the bishop was not amused. Well, in retrospect, I find those stories amusing. But you and I, and people we know, have experienced setbacks and losses and evil events that have left us or them feeling not amused, but devastated. Cancer, dementia, natural disasters, war. After World War II, there were a lot of Jews who could no longer affirm their faith. A couple of weeks ago, I met a lady in town who told me that she can't believe in God because of all the suffering in the world, especially the abuse of children at the hands of priests. I had an army buddy, also named Robert, whose first wife died young, too young. He got mad at God and wouldn't talk to God or about God for the rest of his life until the day he died. If there is a God, that woman said, why does he let this stuff happen? Why doesn't he do something about it? So I wondered whether maybe we ought to talk about this thing that's called the problem of evil. Or as Rabbi Kushner titled his little book, When Bad Things Happen to Good People. Why do bad things happen to good people? I once heard a preacher on a Christian radio station answer that question by saying, bad things do not happen to good people because there are no good people. And he quoted St. Paul, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Well, of course he's right, but in some ways it's not a very satisfying answer. And it does sound a bit glib and self-righteous. And really, it doesn't do justice to scriptures that, like that place in the book of Job, where God says to Job, or where God calls Job, a good and righteous man who fears God and shuns evil. So we need a better answer, or at least a fuller answer. In the story of Job, the passage we heard this morning, we hear of a Sabaean raiding party that stole 1,000 oxen. It says 500 yoke, that's 1,000. And 500 donkeys, and killed all the herdsmen, except for the one herdsman who comes back to tell the story. And we hear of a Chaldean raiding party that steals 3,000 camels and kills all their herdsmen, except for the one herdsman who comes back to tell the story. We also hear about a lightning storm that barbecued 7,000 sheep, and a cyclone that demolished the house, killing all of Job's 7 sons and 3 daughters. Now, Job pretty much shares the worldview of his contemporaries. God is sovereign, so everything that happens can be attributed to God. The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away, blessed be the name of the Lord. When Job's wife, who understandably feels bitter, says, why don't you just curse God and die? Job replies, if we accept good things from God, should we not also be willing to accept sorrows? So while Job shares the view of his contemporaries that God is the agent of these events, he's not willing to blame God for his sorrows. Now, there's a guy who has a right attitude towards God, in spite of not understanding why things happen the way they do. But when Job's 3 friends get into the picture, around about chapter 4, they spend the next 27 chapters inventing sins that they think Job must have committed in order to explain his suffering. Job doesn't know why those things happen to him. And he says so when he complains to God about it. But he does know they're not a punishment for anything he's done. Now, except for some guilt-ridden souls who may have had toxic experiences, the idea that all the bad stuff in our lives is divine punishment is just not an idea that occurs to most people today. If they're skeptics, like the woman I spoke of recently, they're more likely to take the view that if there really is a God, how dare he allow these atrocities? And that question, I think, deserves at least an attempt at an answer. As far as we're able to give one, realizing that any answer is guaranteed to raise more questions. Now, the story of Job may sound like a tall tale, but we can see from Job's four disasters that its author was an astute thinker. What he illustrates is the fact that we experience two kinds of evil. There's the Sabaean raiders, who represent human evil, and they're followed by a lightning storm, which is a natural event, a force of nature. And in case we didn't catch the difference, the author follows these two examples by another pair. There's the Chaldean raiders, who again represent human evil, and they're followed by the cyclone that huffs and puffs and blows the house down and kills all of Job's children. So our lives are subject to two sorts of evil. Human evil, whether it's deliberate malice, like the raiders, or mere stupidity, like placing a laptop on the roof of my car, or the forces of nature that catch us when we're in the wrong place at the wrong time. As Job says later in the story, man is born to trouble, as surely as sparks fly up. Now you may have noticed that in the Tower of Siloam story, Jesus affirms this distinction. Some folks come to him wanting him to comment on the slaughter of certain Galileans by Roman soldiers while those Galileans were in the temple at worship. And the poignant saying is that their blood was mingled with the blood of their sacrifice. Notice that Jesus does not offer an explanation. Instead, like the author of Job, he gives an example of that other sort of evil. The 18 people in the Siloam district of Jerusalem who happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time when the Tower of Siloam collapsed. Death by natural disaster. Jesus didn't answer their concern because he wanted to emphasize that as serious as those events were, there's a much more important concern, which is, very simply, if we're not right with God, an even greater disaster will befall us. But today, I do want to talk about their concern because it does keep people from faith, and I think we can understand the problem in a way that Jesus' audience and Job's audience could not. I think God's toleration of human evil is the easier of the two to get our heads around. Could God have made us so that we would never do anything bad? Of course he could. But then we wouldn't be people. We'd be robots. And our actions would have no virtue, because they would not involve any choice. But we're created in the image of God, so that we might have fellowship with God, and that image includes a degree of freedom that emulates, in human way, God's freedom. It's a terrifying freedom, because it invites us to choose to be a man or a woman after God's own heart, or God. But take away that choice, and we can have no fellowship with God, and our actions have no virtue. I think the ancients understood that. But why God allows natural evil, like lightning strikes and cyclones, and random accidents like the kid back in Canada a couple of years ago who was killed by a stray hockey puck on an ice rink, requires, I think, information that the ancients didn't have. They recognized it, but they didn't understand it. We believe that God is sovereign, and that belief has to be our unshakable starting point. But the writer of Ecclesiastes recognized something that we really need to square with that belief in the sovereignty of God. Ecclesiastes says, "The race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. Nor does food always come to the wise, nor wealth to the brilliant, nor favor to the learned. But time and chance happen to them all, like a fish caught in a cruel net, and birds taken in a snare. So people are trapped by evil times that fall unexpectedly upon them. Time and chance happen to all." How do we square time and chance, random occurrences, with the sovereignty of God? How can random events even happen in a world governed by the laws of nature that we believe God created? Back in 1647, the Westminster Confession stated that God has unchangeably ordained all things whatsoever come to pass. The Confession also insists that that does not make God the author of sin, nor does it violate the free will of his creatures. God ordained everything, but you can't blame him for the bad stuff, and people still make real choices. That is called an antinomy, a pair of conflicting ideas where the conflict has no apparent resolution. Why does that conflict exist? How can we have free will and be accountable if God in his sovereignty has ordained everything that happens? The guys who wrote the Westminster Confession lived in an age when everyone assumed that the laws of nature were fixed and unchangeable. Take the law of gravity for an example. If you trip and fall, I have scars on my knees to prove it happens. If you trip and fall, you always fall down, you never fall up. Natural law works infallibly. But over the past century and a half, scientists have made two discoveries that I think invite us to rethink the problem of how the bad stuff fits into God's sovereignty. Now remember, I'm no scientist. I'm a layman at science, but I'm interested in understanding science in order to make some theological sense of it. One of those discoveries is the fact that the universe is expanding. Everything in the starry heavens is moving farther apart. Since its starting point 13.81 million years ago, the scientists call the Big Bang and we call creation, the fact that the universe is expanding also means that it's like a wound up clock that's winding down. For example, the sun gives us light by burning itself up. And one day, millions of years from now, if the Lord doesn't return first, it will burn out. So it is with every chemical, physical, and biological process in the universe. Scientists call that winding down entropy. The universe consumes itself. And that's not a bad thing. That's how God designed it. You can't have a fire without the fire consuming the wood. You can't grow up without also growing old. That's how the universe works, to produce the materials and the activity that sustain the universe and life itself. A friend back home sent me an email last week with one of those wise quotations that you see on Facebook. This one said, "Don't complain about getting old. It's a luxury that not everyone gets to enjoy." Well, along with the discovery of the expanding universe, the other thing that helps us to understand random events is the discovery of quantum physics. That's the world of elementary particles, bits of matter or energy, smaller than an atom, that seem to behave randomly and not according to fixed laws. For those of us who believe in God, that randomness is also a necessary part of His creation. To illustrate, I'd like you to picture two people sitting on either side of a checkers board. White is supposed to move first. Black has no idea what moves white will make. But what if white doesn't move? Then there's nothing that black can do. If white doesn't make the first move, there's no black move that can follow. If white doesn't do anything, there's no gain. And that, I think, is why God made elementary particles to behave randomly. If there were no randomness in nature, there would be no change, no variation, nothing would happen, the universe would be cold and dead. No mountains and lakes would form, no dead matter would be turned into oil and gas, and there would be no living cells that cause plants and animals and people to grow. There would be none of the constant change that makes up life. Now, scientists say that that randomness behaves according to what they call the anthropic principle. That means it's a controlled randomness that operates within the narrow boundaries necessary to sustain life. So the universe is expanding, but it doesn't fly apart. Weather events are necessary to sustain life, but they sometimes can be treacherous. And when they are, we're usually smart enough to get out of the way. The cells in our bodies grow and replace themselves, but they don't usually grow out of control and become cancerous. There again, believers can see the design of God. Nevertheless, entropy does seem to win in the end. The sun that gives us life can also give us sunstroke. It can set half of California's forests on fire. The behavior of mountains and lakes has buried whole cities. And the cells in our bodies, including those in our brains, do sometimes behave erratically so that we lose our minds and eventually our life. And that random evil in nature is enough to make some people bitter and angry, even bitter and twisted. Unless this world, this life, is not the end game. Unless, as the writer to the Hebrews says, "Here we have no abiding city, but we seek one that is to come." Unless the writer of Job got it right, where in the end, Job's fortunes are restored double, and in a remarkably modern twist, it's Job's three daughters who get real names and identities, while his seven sons were just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 file numbers. We could easily be bitter and angry, unless St. Paul also got it right when he wrote, "I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us. For the whole created universe waits with eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed." For the creation was subjected to entropy, futility, vanity, entropy, not by its own natural forces, but by God who subjected it, for the hope that the universe itself will also be delivered from the bondage of decay into the liberty of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole universe groans and travails in pain together until now. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for adoption, for the redemption of our body. For it is in this hope that we were saved. But hope that is seen is not hope. For who needs to hope for what he sees? And if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. May God give us the patience that comes from hope, and the hope that comes from our faith in Jesus, who died and for our sake rose again.
Please join us standing and sing our last song, "This Is My Father's World."
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and around me rings the music of my sphere. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the fall of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hand in the wondrous wall. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass, I can hear Him pass. Speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me never forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, will be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, will be satisfied, earth and heaven be one. And earth and heaven be one. And earth and heaven be one.
Just an announcement, we will do communion next week. So just to give you a heads up. We celebrate the Lord's Supper.
At the bottom of your apron, a prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time to bring our supplications before you, and who promises that when two or three are gathered together in your name, you will grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of your servants, as may be most expedient for us, granting in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face to shine upon us. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon us and give us peace, now and evermore. Amen.